This is a microcontroller. This is a microcontroller. And this is a microcontroller. A microcontroller is a tiny but complete computer system. They work the same way as a full-size computer, but they are much less powerful. They are, however, much more powerful than you may realize. Also, it takes much less computing power than you may think in terms of the amount of RAM and clock speed required to get useful work done. Microcontrollers are cheap. You can get them for just a few dollars. I bought a 3-pack of these tiny Seed Zao boards on Amazon for $25. That's $25 for three entire dual-core 32-bit computers. Just like a full-size computer, a microcontroller can run programs. You can tell it to do stuff, and it will do that stuff over and over and over again. Microcontrollers are basically free to run. Sure, they take a little power like anything else, but we're talking tens to maybe a few hundred milliamps. Basically nothing. Unlike full-size computers that have a monitor for output and a keyboard and a mouse for input, microcontrollers interface with the outside world through their pins. You can use these pins to read user inputs from knobs, dials, sliders, and switches, and you can use them to read voltage sensors, moisture sensors, motion detectors, and all kinds of other things. A microcontroller can also control relays and other switches to turn a device on or off, or even change their settings in an automated fashion. When you program a microcontroller, what you are really doing is configuring a device to express your will without you actually being the one that has to express it. For example, if you write a program to turn on a fan when a room reaches a certain temperature, the microcontroller will do that for you until the end of time. So long as it has the power and everything hooked up right, and you wrote that program effectively, the end result is equal to you being there and turning on that fan when that fan needs to be turned on. If you have the ability to make a microcontroller perform a function that acts on the outside world, then you have the ability to be in more than one place at a time. Microcontrollers can even act as an extension of your PC, giving you the ability to read and control stuff in the real world. It's extremely useful to be able to gather data from external equipment and display it on a nice, large PC display in real time. When you're programming microcontrollers, wiring up circuits, and hooking up sensors, the possibilities truly are endless. In this video, I'll show you how to get a microcontroller up and running, executing code. I'll go through the basics, and then I'll show you how to hook up an ADS1115 analog-to-digital converter, which drastically increases a microcontroller's capabilities. I'll be using a Key Studio Mega Plus 2560 R3 in this video. If you want more information about this board, then you can check out my brief overview of it here. The examples in this video will work on any board that's compatible with the Arduino IDE, so you don't have to use this one. I'll be using an ADS1115 analog to digital converter and DuPont jumper wires. The first step is to download the Arduino software. You can find this on their website, but honestly, the easiest way to do it is to just Google download Arduino and click the first link. After that, just choose your OS on the page and click just download unless you plan on donating. The Arduino installer is pretty straightforward. You can basically just click next, 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 and you're good. After that, you'll have an Arduino icon on your desktop. Double-click that icon and plug in your board. Before you get started, you'll have to select the board and the port. As long as you're using a standard Arduino board or a clone of one of those boards, you won't have to do anything extra to set up the board in the Arduino IDE. If you're not using an Arduino board or a clone, and you're instead just using a board that's supported by the Arduino IDE, then you'll have to do some more work to set up your board. If, like me, you're using an Arduino Mega 2560 clone or another natively supported Arduino board like the Uno, then all you have to do is choose that board from the AVR boards list. As far as the COM port, you can click ports and it will show you the ports that are already detected in your system. If you only see one and your board is plugged in already, then that's the port you need to select. If you see more than one, that means that you have a built-in or virtual serial port. To find out which one is the Arduino, all you have to do is open the device manager and click ports to expand it. After that, unplug and plug the Arduino back in. The Arduino port will come and go while the built-in or virtual port stays on the screen. Once you've selected the correct board and port, you're good to go. Okay, now that we have everything all installed, set up, and connected, we're ready to program the board. Many Arduino boards and clones have a built-in LED that can be controlled with software. This particular board has a built-in LED on pin 13, so that means whatever's done in software to pin 13 will show up in the onboard LED. How the code works is like this. There are two main areas, the setup and the loop. The setup runs once and the loop runs forever. You can also put things outside of both the setup and the loop at the very top of the page, and that's where you include libraries and do other initialization things like defining global variables. The Arduino IDE has a convenient way to read from and write to the pins, the digital write and digital read functions. When you use a function, there's always a set of parentheses at the end. Sometimes you have to put things in the parentheses and sometimes you don't. That depends on the function. Sometimes you have to put more than one thing in the parentheses, and if you do, those things need to be separated with a comma. The things that go in the parentheses are called arguments. The digital write function requires two arguments, and the digital read function requires just one. Before turning the pin on, however, we need to set it up as an output. To do that, you have to use another function first called pin mode. Pin mode also requires two arguments. To set the pin to an output, simply type this in the setup. Remember, this is basically a sentence of code, and in this language, sentences are ended with a semicolon instead of a period. To use the digital write function to turn pin 13 on, type this. This tells the digital write function which pin you want to work with and what you want to set it to. You can either set it to high or low, or 1 or 0. That's literally all you have to do to tell a microcontroller to send power to a specific pin. To see it in action, click the upload button or hold control and press U. And there we are, the LED is on. What you're seeing is a digital binary 1 in real life. The microcontroller sends a 1 down the line in the form of its running voltage. In the case of this board, the Arduino Uno, and some others, the signal is 5 volts. In other cases, and with other chips, it'll be 3.3 volts. Only a tiny amount of power can be provided this way, but it's more than enough to light up an LED. And don't worry, you can control all kinds of high power stuff with these control signals. You just need some additional hardware to interface it. Okay, so that's sending data. Now let's read some data. To do that, change the pin mode from an output to an input and delete the digital write line and set up the serial port like this. Functions can accept other functions as arguments, so in the loop, type this. What this does is send the output of the digital read function to the serial print line function. After that, upload the code and open the serial terminal. You should see a stream of numbers. Right now, the pin is not connected to anything, so it's just going to be jumping around between 0 and 1 as it picks up interference. So take a jumper wire and connect pin 13 to ground. As you can see, the number goes to 0. For this microcontroller, a binary 0 is 0 volts, and a binary 1 is 5 volts. Now take that pin out of ground and connect it to 5 volts. The number changes to a 1. So what's going on here is the microcontroller over and over again, as fast as it can, is reading the state of that pin. So depending on what the voltage is going into that pin, it's going to report a different state back over the serial terminal. Now do the same thing, but change the pin number to A0 and change digital read to analog read. What this will do is perform an analog read on analog pin 0. So attach a wire to analog pin 0, upload the program, and open the serial terminal. Now you can see numbers flying all over the place. That's just interference. To get a better view of this data, open the serial plotter. Where the digital read function can only return a value from 0 to 1, the analog read function can return a value from 0 to 1023. When the pin is connected to 0 volts, it will obviously output 0, but when the pin is connected to something that has the same voltage that the chip's running at, which in this case is 5 volts, the number will be 1023. So if you connect the pin to 2.5 volts, you'll get an output of 512, which is the halfway point. It's as simple as that to read and write to microcontroller pins. Of course, writing software can be challenging, and what you can do with software can be extremely complex, but it's all built on simple and easy to use functions and rules. Just like full-size computers, microcontrollers are expandable. There are many different types of add-on chips and modules that you can get for microcontrollers. This one is a carbon monoxide sensor, and this one can detect magnetic fields so well, you can use it as a compass. This one here gives a microcontroller the ability to output an analog voltage, and this other board provides a microcontroller the ability to sense motion. Today, we will focus on this one, the ADS1115. This module gives microcontrollers some pretty impressive voltage sensing capabilities. The microcontroller I'm using does have a built-in analog to digital converter, but there are several problems with the built-in ADCs found in microcontrollers. They're known to be very noisy and non-linear, they are very low resolution compared to the add-on boards, and in addition to that, most built-in ADCs can't perform differential measurements. Microcontrollers have an interface similar to USB and PCI Express that add-on boards, modules, and chips use to connect to the microcontroller. For this video, we'll be using I2C. I2C requires just two communication wires and two power wires. All I2C devices share the same pins, so it makes hooking up multiple I2C devices really easy. I've already soldered the pins onto this ADS1115, and if you want to see that process, you can check it out here. The ADS1115 is extremely easy to connect and use. All you have to do is connect SCL, SDA, power, and ground. This board gives me two spots to do that, so I'm going to do it over here. Before using the ADS1115, you'll have to download the library. For this video, I'm using the Adafruit ADS1X15 library, which you can get by going to the Library Manager in the Arduino IDE and searching for for ADS-1X-15. Once you have the library, you need to include it in your program. Do that by placing this line at the very top. Below that, you have to initialize the library by typing this. Then after that, you have to start up the ADS-1115 by placing this line anywhere in the setup. Earlier in the video, I showed you that you can put functions in other functions, but there's a better way to do it using variables. Variables are a way for a program to store data, and every time you make a variable, you have to set what type of number you're going to put in it. For this example, we're working with basic integers, so just above your serial print function, type int reading equals 123. This will make a new variable called reading and set it to 123. Now make your serial print function look like this. What this will do is pass the data stored in the variable to the serial print function. Doing it this way helps keep things organized and readable. Now change the 123 to this. This sets the reading variable to be equal to whatever channel 0 on the ADS-1115 is reading. Changing this number will change the channel that the variable is attached to. Unlike the built-in ADC, which can return a number from 0 to 1023, the ADS-1115 can return a number from 0 to 32,768. Also, unlike the built-in ADC, the ADS-1115 has a built-in voltage reference linked to the gain amplifier. The default gain setting is 2/3, which makes each bit equal to 0.1875 millivolts. So if you're using the default gain and the ADS-1115 returns a value of 17,662, then all you have to do is multiply that value by 0.1875 to get 3,311, which is the reading in millivolts. When doing single-ended measurements, the pin voltage is measured with respect to ground. With the ADS-1115, you can do differential measurements. A differential measurement measures a voltage with respect to another input pin rather than ground. This means that you can measure the voltage before and after a device or component to measure its voltage drop. To do differential measurements, simply exchange the single-ended function with this one. Differential readings require two pins, so this function will measure between channel 0 and 1. If you want to read between channel 2 and 3, just type this. The ADS-1115 also has a programmable gain amplifier that can be set up to 16x. This means that you can measure very small signals such as those produced by a current shunt. Here's a slightly more complicated program, and I'll go through it line by line. This includes the Adafruit ADS-1X-15 library. This creates a new variable called ADS and assigns the library to that variable. It doesn't have to be ADS, it can be anything you want. This creates a new floating point variable called current and doesn't put anything in it. This creates a new floating point variable called voltage and doesn't put anything in it. Here in the setup, the ADS-1115 is turned on, and right below that, the serial system is turned on, and the speed is set to 9600 baud. Now we're to the loop, where everything happens over and over again. This sets the gain to 16x. The ADS-1115 has a built-in programmable gain amplifier. This PGA is extremely helpful for measuring very small voltages. This sets the current variable equal to the output of the differential reading between 0 and 1, and multiplies that by 0.0078125. The reason why I'm multiplying it by that number is because when the gain is set to 16, each bit represents 0.0078125 millivolts. This changes the gain to 2/3, which is the default setting for the ADS-1115. This sets the voltage variable to the output of a single-ended read for channel 3 on the ADS-1115. Because the gain is set to 2/3, each bit is worth 0.1875 millivolts, so we multiply by that number here. This prints the label for the variable on the screen, and that's done 4 more times down the page. If you'll notice, the bottom one, though, is a little different. The LN at the end makes it add a new line when it's done. So everything done before that will be on the same line, and anything done after that will be on a new line. Here's how the program goes through the lines. At the very top, those are done real quick and just once, and then it starts the loop and it won't stop the loop until it loses power. Here's the output of the program. You can see the labels and the variables being printed on a single line over and over again. But the current is not currently being expressed in amps. All it's reading right now is the voltage drop produced by the shunt in millivolts. The voltage isn't right either. It is reading a voltage, but it's not reading the true voltage. It's connected to a voltage divider, which lowers the voltage coming in. So some math has to be done to change that voltage to the actual voltage being measured. So in the next video, I'll be using this setup to monitor the voltage and current of a lithium-ion battery. I'll show how to build a current shunt and a voltage divider, and how to do the math to convert the output of those things into useful, accurate figures. There was a lot covered in this video, and I went through it pretty quickly, but that was kind of the point. If you want to get this stuff working and you have any questions, then I highly recommend you join the Electronics Workshop Discord. There you'll find discussions for batteries, microcontrollers, electronics, and all kinds of other things. Thanks for watching!